If you've ever stepped on a Lego brick or shoved a molten piece of pizza in your mouth, you might think you know pain. Don't get me wrong, it takes some grit to survive stubbing your pinky toe on a coffee table, or even more if you accidentally fracture it. But scientifically speaking, there are some medical conditions that hurt more than a stubbed toe. Like, a lot more. Pain can range from annoying to unpleasant to life-changingly awful. And before we get into five of the most painful conditions, it helps to understand why pain is hard to measure in the first place. Biologically, pain is a way for your brain to tell you, hey, something bad is happening. It's a sensation that helps us protect ourselves from dangerous things. Your nervous system carries all kinds of messages throughout your body, including sensory information about the world. And you have specialized receptors linked to different senses, like photoreceptors in your eyes or taste receptors on your tongue. Nociceptors detect various kinds of damage to your body. When nociceptors are activated, they send signals to your brain, which interprets those signals as ouch. That word interprets is the key. There isn't a pain signal that can be measured in nerve cells or dialed up or down like the volume of a speaker. Pain is a subjective experience that all of our brains process in their own personal ways. So when doctors talk to patients about their experiences, they use tools like visual scales where you can point to different kinds of ouch faces, or numerical scales where you rank the pain you feel from 0 to 10, with 0 being no pain at all and 10 being the worst pain you can imagine. But one person's 3 on a pain scale could be another person's 7. Because there isn't really a universal standard for pain, lots of people end up describing their pain with metaphors, which make their way into medical records and scientific papers. Even though your head isn't literally on fire, or you don't have a knife lodged in your arm, you might describe pain as burning or stabbing to help express the intensity of what you're feeling. All this to say, there might not be an objectively most painful experience, since everyone will have their own answer. So to present you with 5 of the most painful diseases, we're really talking about 5 things that seem extremely painful based on aggregates of subjective experiences. That said, these 5 almost certainly crank the pain scale up to 11. We'll start with a bang, or more specifically, a thunderclap headache. This headache is extremely sudden, like a crack of thunder in a rainstorm, with intense pain ramping up in less than 30 to 60 seconds. And it doesn't seem to have an obvious cause, like being congested from a cold or staring at your computer screen for too long. The term thunderclap headache was first coined in a 1986 case study about a 42-year-old female patient who had 3 of them within a week and said they were like a hammer hitting her head. Since then, other people have described it as the worst headache ever, and thunderclap headache is treated as a medical emergency where doctors need to run more tests because we think that it could be a warning sign of another serious brain-related condition. That 1986 case study was looking at a link between severe headaches and cerebral aneurysms, where blood vessels in the brain get weaker, balloon outward, and potentially burst open or rupture. Specifically, they found an unruptured cerebral aneurysm in their patient, which they were able to treat and seal off before it got worse. But the intense pain of a thunderclap headache could also mean that a blood vessel in your brain did rupture and start to bleed, that there was a change in the fluid pressure in your skull, or that there's a clot keeping blood from flowing to your brain. Since your brain needs the right amount of blood flowing in the right places to deliver oxygen and keep everything working, it's pretty dangerous if any of these things happen. Basically, I can't actually give medical advice, but if this happens to you, the ER might be where you need to go. Now, you can't have thunder without lightning, so it's only fitting that there's also a super painful condition called trigeminal neuralgia, which patients have described as a lightning bolt to the face, or the world's worst pain. It's a sudden, severe, piercing pain that's focused anywhere along the trigeminal nerve, which is the largest nerve that runs beneath the skin of your face and controls many of your facial muscles and sensations. Basically, the trigeminal nerve is how you can chew a bite of brownie or feel a soft kiss on your cheek. And unfortunately, trigeminal neuralgia can turn even the gentlest touch to lightning bolt level agony. This condition was originally called tic douloureux, or painful tic, by the French physician Nicolas André in 1756. He was studying ways to surgically help patients who experienced intense pain and facial spasms. By listening to patients and poking around surgically, he deduced that some kind of pressure or damage to facial nerves was the root cause of tic douloureux. But his treatments were pretty gruesome by modern standards, since they involved cutting open a facial wound and not letting it heal. This prevented the nerve from getting re-squished and being over oversensitive. Nowadays, we think trigeminal neuralgia has a couple different causes. Direct nerve damage from a surgery or an injury, a blood vessel pushing on the nerve, or a different disease like multiple sclerosis that causes the protective coating on the nerve to wear away. And thankfully, our modern treatments are more sophisticated than those of 18th century France. They include surgeries that try to reduce pressure on the nerve, or medications that can reduce how much the trigeminal nerve is sending all kinds of signals, including the nociceptor ones. These treatments can't always make the pain go away, but they can make it a little easier to feel a breeze or bite into a donut.
Thanks to Brilliant for supporting this SciShow video. We upload a new SciShow video almost every single day, partly because there's just so much cool stuff to learn in this world, but also because learning a little bit every day is really good for us all. And Brilliant is 100% on the same page. Brilliant is an online learning platform with thousands of lessons in computer science, math, and science, but not lessons that you sit through hours at a time like in college. Brilliant's lessons are bite-sized so that you can build real knowledge in just minutes whenever you have the time. That way, you can learn just a little bit every day by fitting Brilliant into your life rather than rearranging your whole life. And since Brilliant lessons are created in partnership with college professors from Caltech, Duke, and MIT, you know you're still getting high-quality information. To get all of that knowledge in your head one day at a time, go to brilliant.org/scishow or the link in the description. That link will also give you 20% off an annual premium Brilliant subscription, plus you'll get your first 30 days free.
There's also a super painful group of disorders called hypercontractile esophagus, which can affect your ability to swallow food. And if that medical name doesn't roll off your tongue, there are two less stuffy terms, nutcracker esophagus and jackhammer esophagus. These disorders involve unusually strong muscle contractions along your esophagus from your throat all the way to your stomach. We're not entirely sure what causes jackhammer esophagus, but it's something weird with your nerves, muscle fibers, or the neurotransmitters that help them communicate with each other. The severe chest pain that goes along with these uncontrollable contractions can feel like intense squeezing, and the pain can radiate out to your neck, arm, or back. It can also be mistaken for a heart attack or come with intense heartburn. The term nutcracker esophagus was first used in research papers in the late 1970s or early 1980s to describe non-heart-related chest pain that was linked with extra-strong esophageal contractions. While we can't measure the pain signals, we can actually measure swallowing using a technique called esophageal manometry. Basically, it involves sticking a narrow tube down your throat that gets squeezed by your muscles and records the pressure. From this, we know that nutcracker esophagus kicks swallowing up a notch, hence the pain. But doctors realized that there were some people whose swallowing was even more extreme and painful than nutcracker esophagus, sometimes even with spasms. So around 2012, they coined the term jackhammer esophagus as the new king of this group of disorders. To treat this kind of pain, we usually try to reduce the intensity of these contractions wherever possible by blocking some, but not all, muscle action through medicines or even Botox injections. Because you have nerves all over your body, majorly unpleasant nerve damage can happen anywhere too. That's the underlying problem of complex regional pain syndrome, or CRPS. Its major symptom is a disproportionate amount of pain that can get triggered by pretty much anything from wearing a scratchy fabric to just trying to move your body. Plus, a limb with CRPS can swell up, get unusually sweaty, have unusual hair growth, lose muscle or bone, change color, or even start looking like scar tissue, because nerves help control all those processes and more. There's been documentation of conditions sort of like CRPS for hundreds of years, even if people weren't using that exact term. In 1813, for instance, a British surgeon described a soldier wounded by a bullet in his arm who seemingly healed but had a lingering, violent pain of a burning nature. The surgeon actually compared the symptoms to tic douloureux, that old French term for a trigeminal neuralgia. Or in 1864, an American Civil War doctor named Silas Weir Mitchell described soldiers who suffered from chronic burning pain after their gunshot wounds seemed to heal, and he named it causalgia. We eventually landed on complex regional pain syndrome as a name and two main diagnoses. CRPS2 is more straightforward. It's a result of nerve damage, like from surgery or all those gunshot wound case studies in the past. But there's also CRPS1, which sets in after illness or injury, even if nerves weren't directly damaged, possibly because the immune system did something weird while healing and your nociceptors become extra sensitive in the process. Unfortunately, because we don't fully understand the causes of CRPS, it's hard to treat it. other than trying to reduce pain with medication and physical therapy. That American doctor, Silas Weir Mitchell, kept plenty busy studying nerve damage, and he wrote about our fifth condition in an 1878 paper. Erythromelalgia causes extreme burning pain and bright redness in patients' extremities like hands and feet. This condition is also nicknamed man on fire syndrome, which pretty much explains all you need to know about its intensity. A flare can be triggered by anything that gets your blood pumping or warms you up, from exercise to spicy food. One patient has described flares as if they're placing their hand on the burner of a stove or like walking across hot coals. The causes are still a little mysterious, but we think some patients have a mutation in a protein called a voltage-gated sodium channel, specifically one named NaV1.7. Sodium channels in general help nerve cells communicate with each other, and we think NaV1.7 channels are specifically important in nociceptors and sensing pain. In patients with man-on-fire syndrome, we see overactive forms of NaV1.7, which means their nerves are signaling more than normal and lead to the brain screaming, "Ouch!" even when there isn't a damage-causing sensation. To treat erythromelalgia, patients are given medications that can numb or reduce the pain in some way by interfering with nerve signaling. And even though some people try to use ice baths to counteract the burning sensation, that can be dangerous because you might damage your skin even worse with cold. So it's sort of a lose-lose situation. All five of these extremely painful medical conditions rely on researchers and other professionals to believe patients when they say something hurts. Because pain is subjective, we have to trust the people who are experiencing it. Many of these painful conditions are also rare, and fewer patients mean fewer opportunities to study them and find treatments that work, or for these patients to find community with other people who get it. So, as with everything in science, the work continues, and anything we can do to demystify how pain works and how the nervous system can go wrong will probably also reduce the suffering these people endure.